So this is a poem called Colibrí, which is one of the many Spanish words for hummingbird. The Taino word, by the way, was guacarilla. And I'm going to read this poem first in Spanish and then in English, a short poem. Colibrí, para mi esposa Catherine, un año después. En Jayuya, los lagartijos se dispersan como una flota de canoas verdes ante el invasor. Los españoles conquistaron con hierro y palabras. Indio taíno para el pueblo que tomaba la vida de la lluvia arrojada entre los árboles como flechas evaporándose. Ellos que dejaron huellas, no roca, de ojos y bocas en círculos perfectos de espanto. Y el zumbador fue bautizado Colibrí. Ahora el colibrí se precipita, se estrella entre los muros blancos de la hacienda, un corazón taíno agitado, frenético, como si oyera el bramio del dios de la pólvora por primera vez. El colibrí, presa paralizada, cae en la más pura quietud, cuando tus manos lo acopan y lo alzan por las celosías rojas de la ventana, donde se desaparece en un paraíso celeste, un anochecer de coquilles. Si la historia solo fuera como tus manos. Colibrí, my wife Catherine, 1 year later. In Jayuya, the lizards scatter like a fleet of green canoes before the invader. The Spanish conquered with iron and words. Indio Taino for the people who took life from the rain that rushed through trees like evaporating arrows, who left the rock carvings of eyes and mouths in perfect circles of amazement. So the hummingbird was christened Colibrí. Now the colibrí darts and bangs between the white walls of the hacienda, a racing Taino heart frantic as if hearing the bellowing god of gunpowder for the first time. The colibrí becomes pure stillness, seized in the paralysis of the prey when your hands cup the bird and lift him through the red shutters of the window where he disappears into a paradise of sky, a nightfall of singing frogs. If only history were like your hands. People in the back, plenty of seats here in the front. Come on up. What? I'm not going to make you sing or anything. Well, at the end of that poem, I talk about singing frogs. I'm not talking about Kermit the Frog. I'm talking about the coqui that sings at night in Puerto Rico. Of course, this is the basis of my theory that Kermit the Frog is actually Puerto Rican. His name is Gamita. Well, I am originally from the tropical paradise of Brooklyn, New York. I'm from the East New York section of Brooklyn, and when I was a kid growing up, I kept hearing about this paradise called Puerto Rico, and went for the first time when I was about 10, and I've been back many times since. But the first visit is unique, and that's what this next poem is about. It's also about what I call the taste of colonialism, which almost sounds like a jingle. Because colonialism is in what you eat and what you drink, and certainly the way you think. And Puerto Rico has been a colony of the United States now for 100 years. So this is my my cultural imperialism on vacation poem. Coca-Cola and Coco Frio. On his first visit to Puerto Rico, island of family folklore, the fat boy wandered from table to table with his mouth open. At every table, some great aunt would steer him with cool spotted hands to a glass of Coca-Cola. One even sang to him in all the English he could remember a Coca-Cola jingle from the 40s. He drank obediently, though he was bored with this potion, familiar from soda fountains in Brooklyn. Then, at a roadside stand off the beach, the fat boy opened his mouth to Coco Frio, a coconut chilled and scalped by a machete so that a straw could inhale the clear milk. The boy tilted the green shell overhead and drew coconut milk down his chin. Suddenly, Puerto Rico was not Coca-Cola or Brooklyn. And neither was he. For years afterward, the boy marveled at an island where the people drank Coca-Cola and sang jingles from World War II in a language they did not speak. While so many coconuts in the trees sag, heavy with milk, swollen and unsuckled. I just love creating a fire hazard.
Fire prevention.
Oh, that's good. Well, then we can have a drill later. Every Puerto Rican poet has to have a cockroach poem. No, it's true. When I was a kid growing up in New York, everybody thought we brought the cockroaches with us. It's true. I mean, like we were getting on a plane in San Juan with these big jars full of cockroaches and, you know, shaking them out in the street, you know, go, my children, you're free. So here's my contribution. It's called My Cockroach Lover. The summer I slept on JC's couch, there were roaches between the bristles of my toothbrush. Roaches pouring from the speakers of the stereo. A light flipped on in the kitchen at night revealed a Republican National Convention of roaches. An Indianapolis 500 of roaches. One night I dreamed a giant roach leaned over me, brushing my face with kind antenna and whispering, I love you. I awoke slapping myself and watched the darkness for hours because I realized this was a dream, and so that meant the cockroach did not really love me. Very sad poem. I've had a lot of jobs, and that's really where I got my education. And so that's where this next poem is coming from. I learned about love in a gas station. Yeah, and you never know who your teachers are gonna be. You never know. So this is a poem called Rednecks, Gaithersburg, Maryland. As Scott Gass, Darnestown Road, the high school boys pumping gas would snicker at the rednecks. Every Saturday night there was Earl puckering his liquor-smashed face to announce that he was driving across the bridge, a bridge spanning only the whiskey river that bubbled in his stomach. Earl's car, one side crumpled like his nose, would circle slowly around the pumps, turn signal winking relentlessly. Another pickup truck morning, and rednecks. Loitering in our red uniforms, we watched as a pickup rumbled through. We expected, fill it with no lead, boy, and give me a cash ticket. We expected the farmer with sideburns and a pompadour. We, with new diplomas framed at home, never expected the woman. Her face was a purple rubber mask melting off her head, scars rippling down where the fire seared her freak face, leaving her a carnival where high school boys paid a quarter to look and look away. No one took the pump. The farmer saw us standing in our red uniforms, a regiment of illiterate conscripts. Still watching us, he leaned across the seat of the truck and kissed her. He kissed her all over her happy, ruined face. Kissed her as I pumped the gas and scraped the windshield and measured the oil. He kept kissing her. So, Gassette learned about love in the gas station. Here's another work poem. And I guess it's about not taking anybody's labor for granted. It's called Who Burns for the Perfection of Paper. At 16, I worked after high school hours at a printing plant that manufactured legal pads. Yellow paper stacked 7 feet high and leaning as I slipped cardboard between the pages, then brushed red glue up and down the stack. No gloves. Fingertips required for the perfection of paper, smoothing the exact rectangle. Sluggish by 9 p.m., the hands would slide along suddenly sharp paper and gather slits thinner than the crevices of the skin, hidden. Then the glue would sting, hands oozing till both palms burned at the punch clock. 10 years later, in law school, I knew that every legal pad was glued with the sting of hidden cuts, that every open law book was a pair of hands upturned and burning. So I became a lawyer, a lot easier than working in a factory. And I was a tenant lawyer in Greater Boston. I worked with a program called Su Clínica Legal, legal services program for low-income Spanish-speaking tenants. I wrote a series of poems about that. I'll read one of them now. This is an exchange that actually happened in Chelsea District Court. And it's called Tires Stacked in the Hallways of Civilization. Yes, Your Honor, they're rodents, said the landlord to the judge. But I let the tenant have a cat. Besides, he stacks his tires in the hallway. The tenant confessed in stuttering English, just, Your Honor, I am from El Salvador, and I put my tires in the hallway. The judge puffed up his robes like a black bird shaking off rain. Tires out of the hallway. You don't live in a jungle anymore. This is a civilized country. So the defendant was ordered to remove his tires from the hallways of civilization and allowed to keep the cat. Oh yeah. That's why I love watching these lawyer shows on television, you know, Ally McBeal. Yeah, right. Anyway, because all her cases are about love. Okay, now I want to read a more recent poem, a newer poem. I needed a holly poem. This is about Thanksgiving. I know it's kind of a dubious holiday, but this is a poem about the first time I went and had Thanksgiving dinner with my wife's family. And I have to understand they live in a place called Rocky Hill, Connecticut. No rocks, no hill, but dairy farm country. And you know, outside of Hartford, which now is about 35% Puerto Rican, something like that. So for these farming communities, naturally, the stereotype grew up, and the Puerto Rican had now become the boogeyman. So imagine what it was like when my wife brought the boogeyman home for Thanksgiving dinner. You probably heard of this thing called poetic license, the poet's right to make stuff up. I didn't need it. True story, and it's called Thanksgiving. This was the first Thanksgiving with my wife's family, sitting at the stained pine table in the dining room. The wood stove coughed during her mother's prayer, amen, and the gravy boat bobbing over fresh linen. Her father stared into the mashed potatoes and saw a white battleship floating in the gravy. Still staring at the mashed potatoes, he began a soliloquy about the new Navy missiles fired across miles of ocean, how they could jump into the smokestack of a battleship. Now in Korea, he said, I was a gunner, and the people there ate kimchi, and it really stinks. Mother complained that no one was eating the creamed onions. Eat, Daddy. The creamed onions look like eyeballs, I thought, and then said, I wish I had missiles like that. Daddy laughed a 1950s horror movie mad scientist laugh and told me he didn't have a missile, but he had his own cannon. Daddy, eat the candied yams. Mother hissed, as if you were a liquored CIA spy telling secrets about military hardware to some Puerto Rican janitor he met in a bar. I'm a toolmaker. I made the cannon myself, he announced, and left the table. Daddy's family has been here in the Connecticut Valley since 1680, Mother said. There were Indians here once, but they left. When I started dating her daughter, her mother called me a half-black, but now she spooned candied yams on my plate. I nibbled at the candied yams. I remembered my own Thanksgivings in the Bronx, Turkey, with arroz y bichuelas and plátanos, and countless cousins swaying to Boogaloo on the record player, or roaring in my grandmother's Spanish punchlines in the kitchen, the glowing of her cigarette like a firefly lost in the city. For years, I thought everyone ate rice and beans with turkey at Thanksgiving. Daddy returned to the table with a cannon, steering the black iron barrel. Does that cannon go boom? I asked. I fire it in the backyard at the tombstones, he said. That cemetery bought all our farmland during the Depression. Now we only have the house. He stared and said nothing, then glanced up suddenly like a ghost that tickled his ear. Want to see me fire it? He grinned. Daddy, fire the cannon after dessert, Mother said. If I fire the cannon, I have to take out the cannonballs first, he told me. He tilted the cannon downward, and cannonballs dropped from the barrel, thudding on the floor and rolling across the brown braided rug. Grandmother praised the turkey's thighs, said she would bring leftovers home to feed her Congo gray parrot. I walked with Daddy to the backyard, past the bullet holes in the door, and his pickup truck with the Confederate license plate. He swiveled the cannon around to face the tombstones on the other side of the backyard fence. This way, if I hit anybody, they're already dead, he declared. He stuffed half a charge of gunpowder into the cannon and lit the fuse. From the dining room, Mother yelled, Daddy, no! Then the battlefield rumbled under my feet. My head thundered. Smoke drifted over the tombstones. Daddy laughed, and I thought, when the first drunken pilgrim dragged out the cannon at the first Thanksgiving, that's when the Indians left. Yes. Sometimes people ask me, aren't you worried they're going to read that? I say, nope. Okay. Let's see. I want to do a poem now. Let's see if I can do two more. I'm going to try to work in two more. And this is a poem that was censored by National Public Radio. The program All Things Considered, Washington, D.C., they solicited a poem, they commissioned a poem from me, which they had done in the past. This was a poem for National Poetry Month, April 1997. It was supposed to be in a journalistic vein. So I went to Philadelphia, and I wrote a poem about a man named Mumia Abu-Jamal. It's a name that's familiar to some of you. Mumia Abu-Jamal is an African-American journalist, an intellectual, a writer. He's also on death row, wrongly convicted in the killing of a Philadelphia police officer, and there is an international movement to win him a new trial. So I went to Philadelphia, and I read in the newspapers about a motion by one of Mumia's lawyers to introduce testimony by an unnamed prostitute who might have evidence to exonerate him. And then I went across the bridge into Camden, New Jersey, and I visited the tomb of Walt Whitman. And I remembered from Song of Myself verses that Whitman wrote about the fugitive slave and giving safe harbor to this fugitive slave. And I thought, who are the fugitive slaves today? Well, this nameless prostitute, or perhaps Mumia himself. And so this poem came out of it, not only with Mumia, but Walt Whitman and his tomb, too. And I sent the poem to NPR, and they were very, very open about it. They refused to air the poem because it was about Mumia and because of its political sympathies. So, this is the poem NPR didn't want you to hear. Judge for yourself. Another nameless prostitute says the man is innocent for Mumia Abu-Jamal. The board-blinded windows knew what happened. The pavement sleepers of Philadelphia groaning in their ghost-infested sleep knew what happened. Every black man blessed with a gashed eyebrow of nightsticks knew what happened. Even Walt Whitman knew what happened, poet a century dead, keeping vigil from the tomb on the other side of the bridge. More than 15 years ago, the cataract stare of the cruiser's headlights, the impossible angle of the bullet, the tributaries and lakes of blood, Officer Faulkner dead, suspect Mumia shot in the chest, the witnesses who saw a gunman running away, his heart and feet thudding. The nameless prostitutes know, hunched at the curb, their bare legs chilled, their faces squinted to see that night, bruised with fading bruises, now the faces fade. Perhaps an eyewitness putrefies, eyes open in a bed of soil, or floats in the warm Gulf Stream of her addiction, or hides from the fanged whispers of the police in the tomb of Walt Whitman, where the granite door is open and fugitive slaves may rest. Mumia, the panther beret, the thinking dreadlocks, dissonant words that swarm the microphone like a hive, sharing meals with people named Africa, calling out their names even after the police bombardment that charred their black bodies. So the governor has signed the death warrant, The executioner's needle would flush the poison down into Mumia's writing hand so the fingers curl like a burned spider. His calm, questioning mouth would grow numb, and everywhere radios sputter to silence in his memory. The veiled prostitutes are gone, gone to the segregated balcony of whores. But the newspaper reports that another nameless prostitute says the man is innocent, that she will testify at the next hearing. Beyond the courthouse, a multitude of witnesses chants, praise, shouts for his prison to collapse a shack in a hurricane. Mumia. If the last nameless prostitute becomes an unraveling turban of steam, if the judge's robes become clouds of ink swirling like octopus deception, if the shroud becomes your Amish quilt, if your dreadlocks are snipped during autopsy, then drift above the ruined RCA factory that once birthed radios to the tomb of Walt Whitman, where the granite door is open and fugitive slaves may rest. Thank you. And I'll finish my reading with this poem, and then those of you who have to leave at 12 can do so. I think that clock is a few minutes fast, actually. There'll be time after I finish the reading for questions, yes, and then book signing pandemonium. This is a poem about my son and for my son, who is almost 7 years old. Remarkable child, if I do say so myself. And yet we almost lost him when he was 6 weeks old. This is the story of how that happened. We were at Mass General Hospital. He got a condition called RSV, which is a virus that causes pneumonia and sometimes heart failure. So we moved in with him, and this is what happened next. The poem also departs from the literal translation of his name, Clemente, which means in Spanish, merciful, and that's the title of the poem, because Clemente means merciful, for Clemente Gober Espada, and I'll finish with this. At 3 a.m., we watched the emergency room doctor press a thumb against your cheekbone to bleach your eye with light. The spinal fluid was clear, drained from the hole in your back, but the x-ray film drew a stain on the lung, explained the seizing cough, the wailing heat of fever. Pneumonia at the age of 6 weeks, a bedside vigil. Your mother slept beside you, the stitches of birth still burning. When I asked, will he be okay? No one would answer, yes. I closed my eyes and dreamed my father dead, naked on a steel table as I turned away. In the dream, when I looked again, my father had become my son. So the hospital kept us. The oxygen mask, a frayed wire taped to your toe for reading the blood, the medication forgotten from shift to shift, a doctor bickering with radiology over the film, the bald girl with a cancerous rib removed, the pediatrician, who never called, the yawning intern, the hospital roommate's father from Guatemala, ignored by the doctors as if he had picked their morning coffee. The check marks and initials at 5 a.m., the pages of forms flipping like a deck of cards, record keeping for the records office, the lawyers, and the morgue. One day, while the laundry in the basement hissed white sheets, and sheets of paper documented dwindling breath, you spat mucus, gulped air, and lived. We listened to the bassoon of your lungs, the cadenza of the next century resonate. The Guatemalan father did not need a stethoscope to hear the breathing, and he grinned. I grinned too, and because Clemente means merciful, stood beside the Guatemalteco, repeating in Spanish everything that was not said to him. I know someday you'll stand beside the Guatemalan fathers. Speak in the tongue of all the shunned faces. Breathe in the music we have never heard. And live by the meaning of your name. Thank you.